Good morning. Welcome to the 13th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We've received apologies from the convener. I'll therefore be chairing this meeting in his place. We're joined today by Keith Brown, MSP, who is attending the meeting as the substitute member in the convener's absence. Pleased to welcome Keith to the meeting and invite him to declare any relevant interests.
I'm advised I have no interest in the register of interests, but I would mention that I'm a member of the local government pension scheme.
Thanks very much. Agenda item one, we continue our inquiry into effective Scottish Government decision making. Today we are joined remotely by Sophie Howe, Sustainability Futures and Wellbeing Advisor and former Future Generations Commissioner for Wales, Professor Steve Martin, Director of the Wales Centre for Public Policy, Cardiff University, and Professor Matthew Flinders from the University of Sheffield. I welcome you all to the meeting. Thanks for giving us your time. I intend to allow up to 90 minutes for this session, and we will move straight to questions. If any of members wish to come in on any question, I'd be grateful. Sorry, if any of the witnesses should wish to come in on any of the questions, I'd be grateful if you could post that in the chat function, and I will know to bring you in at that point. Committee colleagues, if you could please name the witnesses or the first witness that you want to put a question to, and I will then indicate, as I say, afterwards who wants to come in. To kick off, I think Liz Smith.
Thank you and good morning. One of the key issues that has been exercising our minds as a committee over all the evidence in these sessions is about how effective is the clarity of purpose when it comes to decision making, given that, you know, if we don't have that clarity, it's very difficult to get good quality decision making. So I just wondered if I could open up with asking you as to how easy do you find it to set in motion that clarity of purpose? Do you have a good understanding of what the clarity of purpose is when it comes to decision making?
Somebody first, Liz?
We will go to Wales first.
And we're in Wales. Steve Martin.
Good morning. Thank you for the invitation. I'm really pleased to be here with Sophie and Matt to share what we can this morning. I should explain that my role is not as a policy maker, it's as an academic working in a evidence centre whose role is to provide evidence to both Welsh Government ministers and officials, but also public services in Wales. But I think where we come into contact with your question is that we're often presented with evidence needs, but we then engage in a dialogue with whichever policymakers it is who are asking us about evidence around that topic in order to properly understand what it is that they need and why. And that's where the clarity of purpose, I think, becomes really into sharp focus for us. And part of our role, I hope, is to help policymakers to think through that issue of what exactly is it that they're trying to achieve and how. And it's often helpful to disentangle those two questions. So we get asked sometimes for evidence, which is presented as an evidence need. I want to know how to do X, Y, Z. A very early example, we met with the then Deputy Minister for Tackling Poverty. One of his first requests to us was, I want to know how to establish a network of credit unions across Wales, similar to that which they have in the Republic of Ireland. And I was amazed to hear myself impertinently say, that's really interesting, Minister. Can we understand a little bit about what it is that network of credit unions would be aiming to achieve for you in terms of policy objectives? And that led to a whole discussion about the underlying social and political and economic challenge that the Minister was wanting to address, to which it turned out credit unions were probably not the answer or were only a small part of the answer. So I think disentangling what you're trying to achieve from the way in which you're trying to achieve it is a really important part of the policy process here, presumably in Scotland, certainly in other territories which I've had interactions with. And evidence can feed into questions like, is it a problem for who and where? But it can equally well feed into, what have other people done about this issue? I want to do something about it. I'm sure it's a problem. All of my constituents are telling me it is. what have others done about it? Or sometimes we're getting asked a question further down the line. I know it's a priority for me as a minister. I understand what I want to do about it. And what is the best way for me then to go about delivering that change which I want to achieve? At which point we get into questions about evidence to feed implementation.
Professor Martin,
Thank
you, Professor Martin. That is interesting, the distinction you have made about really two processes that you have to advise on with the minister. When it comes to the second process, in other words, looking at the evidence and guiding the minister into the data that might have been there previous to the decision that's about to be made, how easy do you find that? As in, are you data rich? Or are there gaps in the knowledge that you have to provide to the minister?
It's more the latter than the former, but it does depend on the topic and the policy challenge, as you would expect. We have a process which we go through, in discussion with policymakers, to establish whether this is an issue which we can meaningfully contribute to, and where there's no evidence at all, the answer is, I'm really sorry, there isn't any evidence that we can find across the world. There are no experts who we can find who can advise you on it. That's really quite rare. And in those circumstances, what we'd be recommending is that a process of primary research is undertaken, or some pilots are launched, or some experiments, trials, rapid turnaround, try some things and find out what does and doesn't work. More usually, we're in a world between very rigorous academic research evidence, which often isn't there, but some really helpful expertise which we can bring in from academia and pitch to research colleagues. Sort of question, if you were the minister, what would be your best guess about what to do? And that's not a very purist view of evidence, but we found that that's much more helpful than saying, sorry, there's no randomised control trial on this issue. There's nothing that the academic community has to say on it. But more often than not, we find that there's evidence that we can deploy, but the quality and nature of that evidence varies.
Okay. And is it relatively quick to be able to access that information that you require?
Our modus operandi is designed to be much more timely than traditional academic research, because we're drawing on evidence and expertise that's already in existence. At our very fastest during the pandemic, we turned around some think pieces in a couple of weeks. More usually, we probably are spending 4 to 5 months from the first discussion we have with a policymaker through to the end of a piece of work.
Thank you. That's very helpful. May I just come to the other two witnesses that we have as to whether you have identified any difficulties in establishing the clarity of purpose in what you're trying to achieve?
Would you like me to come in there? So I think that Wales is relatively unique in that we're quite clear on our clarity of purpose, both in the short and long term, because the Wellbeing of Future Generations Act sets out 7 long-term wellbeing goals that our government and all of our public institutions are required to set objectives to achieve. So all policy making should be done within the context of those 7 wellbeing goals. And as I said, they're long term, so they span beyond political cycles, if you like. I think they're, I suppose, a level above the sorts of requests that perhaps Steve was describing there. And I think what Steve was describing is ministers looking to take steps to achieve those wellbeing objectives, and then, you know, what steps should they take, and the various process and discussions that he would go through there. But the clarity of purpose is there, and it's set out in law. The other part of that law, which I think is really important for decision making and the policy making context, is a requirement to demonstrate that government and others across the public sector have applied 5 ways of working, and those are considering the long-term impact of the things that they do, preventing problems from occurring or from getting worse, integrating their actions across government and indeed across other sectors, collaborating with each other and involving citizens. So that provides a sort of framework by which, you know, the decision should be taken, and the 7 wellbeing goals provide the purpose for taking those decisions, or the vision, if you like, for the country. And, you know, my experience is that that's not always operating absolutely perfectly. But what it does do is provide not just for government, but for the whole of Wales, the public sector organisations that are covered by the Future Generations Act, and increasingly those not even covered by the Act, knowing where it is that Wales is headed. I suppose it's a bit like your outcomes framework, but it's set out in law.
That's very helpful. And can I just say at this point that several of us around the table had an excellent visit to the Welsh Synod just a couple of months ago, and we were really very taken with quite a few of the things that we were hearing then. So please pass that back. Yeah. And could Thank I just finish with our final witness on this clarity of purpose? Sheffield.
Matthew Flinders. Sorry, we're not.
I think maybe Wales is.
Sorry, we didn't catch the start of that. Maybe just start again, Professor Flinders.
Of course. Good morning, everybody. I think the issue around clarity of purpose is often the key challenge. Ministers, particularly, will feel they want to do something. What that something is up for discussion. And often the role of working with external advisors, academics in various centres, is to narrow down what is actually the problem solved here. And often that's a key challenge, because in many really super wicked policy areas with overlaid different issues, actually narrowing down what the core problem is that needs to be addressed can actually be more challenging than is often really understood. The other interesting issue, just following on the other speakers, is that when we talk about evidence, it's interesting to think what we actually mean. I think now there is a much broader understanding of the need to combine different sorts of what we might call useful knowledge, the academic knowledge, professional knowledge, experiential lived experience knowledge. And sometimes taking that broad approach to evidence, the evidence doesn't all flow in the same direction. That can be a real challenge. Also, one of the main things that's happened in recent years is the development of an infrastructure which is designed to bring academic research much closer to policymakers at different levels of government. I'm not saying it always worked, but there are clearly a lot more boundary-spanning structures that are designed to try to close the gap between research and policy than there ever were in the past.
Thank you. Could you just give us an example, Professor Flinders, of where evidence, different types of evidence have pointed in an opposite direction and the difficulties that might have caused for you?
Well, I mean, you know, rough sleeping is a classic example there. Rough sleeping for one minister might be around getting people off of the streets into temporary accommodation or hostels. The issue there is that rough sleeping itself, it may well be manifested in people choosing to be homeless, but the root issue is often far more complex: mental health, alcohol, drugs dependency. So unless you are able to approach that problem in a rounded way, you might deal with the rather obvious manifestation, but you won't deal with the root issue. And I think that's one of the issues around the policymaking dimension, that often policymaking interventions are relatively short-term. I often talk about this idea of there's a spark, there's an injection of money, resources, and then what happens when that funding finishes? There is often a lack of development about the interaction between different policy approaches, between housing, mental health, education, or there's a failure to develop a notion of policy momentum that understands that a policy will be finishing, the funding stream is going to finish, but what happens next? Very often we end up throwing mud at walls to see what sticks, and very often very little sticks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us. I wanted to ask a couple of questions of yourself, Professor Flinders, and it's from a slightly kind of academic perspective. Now, in your submission, you make comments about culture and behaviour and avoiding groupthink, confirmation bias and so on. And you also point out the need for critical friends. But my question to you is, how is that limited when power comes into play, where power over someone's job, power over someone's career, and power over their future line of funding if they're a third sector organisation reliant on government? Can you just give us some general thoughts about A, how prevalent that is, and B, how commonly that is understood as a risk in the public sector?
Yes, I think that one of the great challenges, which is almost a contextual issue, is that we have a rather, I would say, immature often approach to accountability and scrutiny. It is often around finding out what went wrong, who is to blame, and who should take responsibility. Now, that is obviously one part of the discussion, but what that approach, what I would call a gotcha mentality, it creates a rather negative view of accountability structures where people will not often speak with candor because they're scared of the implications that may have for them or for their minister, and then by definition will have on them. So one of the key issues is, how do we create a culture where accountability is seen as about both finding out what went wrong, instead of finding out who's to blame, has an equally strong emphasis on what can we learn from that experience from the future? Because at the moment, our structures tend to be largely blame-focused rather than learning-focused. And actually, I would just say I completely understand the issues you're raising about power and implications for honest, straight talking. But in my experience, I very rarely worked with ministers who weren't happy to face constructive feedback and challenge as long as it was evidence-based. So I think it's often not a case of not being able to challenge. It's about being able to challenge, but based on a sound understanding of the existing evidence. And often ministers really want that challenge.
Okay. Thank you for that. Leading on from that slightly, you also make in your submission allude to complexity. Right. That exciting question. We need to wait. Hello.
Wait. Okay, we appear to have lost Professor Flinders. Will we try and get him back? Can maybe, is there... We also seem to have two Steve Martins. Maybe one of the Steve Martins could answer the question that Michelle Thompson possibly puts it to.
I suspect you'll have a view on this as well, Professor. Following on my questions there to Professor Flinders, where we were talking about culture and behaviours, I was going on to ask about complexity and how complexity's relationship with risk and therefore limitations on innovation. Based on your experience of what you've seen, how does appetite for risk or attitude to risk linked in with complexity inadvertently limit innovation in the public sector in general terms?
Sure. I think Sophie probably wants to come in on this as well, and we'll have more interesting things to say than I wanted to come in on your previous question, if that's all right, just around how do we create a culture in which criticism can be constructive and not raise all sorts of antibodies within the system. And I think that does relate to this question of complexity that you were just raising, and maybe Matt can come in now as well. We have an interesting relationship with ministers in that we're part funded by Welsh Government, but also funded by a research council and Cardiff University. And we've had to navigate with ministers this question of how do we give honest, independent evidence, which is at times challenging and doesn't necessarily point in the direction that ministers would have wanted it to. And I think that's a lot about developing the trusting relationships, which I know you've talked about with other witnesses in previous sessions. It's a lot about how we as advisors conduct ourselves. And I completely understand why policymakers might be wary of working with academics. The caricature is we take ages to report anything and then we heavily caveat everything that we say. And there's always a risk that we go into critical mode and start kind of spouting in the media in a way which is very unhelpful. So in the role that we've got, we've had to be absolutely clear that we will follow wherever the evidence leads, but we will transmit that to ministers in a way which isn't going to cause them any difficulty or surprises. So we have a publications protocol, for example, which sounds very boring, but has proved really important, where we present the evidence that we've been able to assemble to ministers. They have 6 weeks to assimilate that, and then we make sure that it's published more widely so that everybody can have access to what we're doing. And that steers a sort of middle course between not working in secret and depriving other policymakers of the evidence which we're providing to ministers, so there can be proper scrutiny of the evidence which they're receiving and questions to them about why they're not following that if they choose not to, and that's absolutely their right not to. But at the same time, creating an environment where they can trust us, that we're trying to be constructive and helpful to them in helping to inform their decisions. So it sounds dull and it sounds obvious, but I really do think it's about the relationships, about the culture and about the behaviour. And it's really important that if researchers want to engage with policy and practice, they're willing to take on some of the kind of constraints that relationship involves.
That's very helpful, thank you. That kind of continuous improvement middle road that academia has brought, that's something worth the committee exploring further when we look at comparables in Scotland. But I know Sophie wanted to come in with my earlier point, and then I'll head back to Professor Flinders. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm not sure if... Can I just check that you can see me? I can't see myself, so I'm not sure if you've lost me.
No, we can't see you, but we can hear you very clearly.
Right, OK. I just wanted to pick up on the point around the sort of... that Matt made around the sort of immature approach to scrutiny. And certainly, you know, we have seen that during my time as Future Generations Commissioner, in terms particularly of the government's willingness to self-reflect, I suppose, and be honest in that sort of self-reflection. I mean, it's quite interesting, actually, that the Welsh Government changed some of these requirements for local government to focus more around performance reporting and self-reflection and peer review and so on. But actually, I think the government itself finds that doing that itself within its own organisation quite challenging. And that's not really a kind of, it's a slight criticism, but I've got some sympathy for that, because everything that is around the government makes that quite difficult to do. If we look at our processes around audit, generally there's going to be more of a focus on, if you've tried to do something new and different and a bit innovative but failed, rather than just continue to manage the status quo. If we think about the kind of politics of government, that's often quite unforgiving if there are mistakes, and likewise in terms of the media. And I think that sort of environment makes it quite difficult for a government to enter into a space where they might feel like they're washing their dirty linen in public, if you like. They might see it as that. I think I would see it, and I think perhaps my colleagues don't want to speak for them, but I think my colleagues might see it as an important part of a kind of self-improvement journey if you're able to genuinely reflect on where you are. Now, as Future Generations Commissioner, my job was to monitor and assess the progress that the government and all of our public institutions were making on meeting the 7 wellbeing goals. And we actually did that through a self-reflection exercise. The first one that we did back in 2019 was really interesting, because what we saw is those organisations who were saying, all is good here, nothing to see here, we're all doing incredibly well. And those were the organisations actually that we took a much deeper look at the organisations who were genuinely reflecting and having those kind of critical conversations within a framework that we co-created with them, which was to look at, okay, you know, where are we on this sort of, you know, improvement journey, if you like? What are the barriers to us making progress? You know, how could we address those barriers? You know, are there things that we could be doing better with partners or better internally? Those organisations, in my experience of the kind of 7 years of being Future Generations Commissioner, are the organisations that have kind of continued to make more progress. The organisations who have perhaps not wanted to wash the dirty linen in public are the organisations who you don't necessarily make that same level of progress. And that was one of the reasons why I use my powers as commissioner. I have powers under Section 20 of the Future Generations Act to conduct a review into, well, it could be into a particular organisation or a collection of organisations. I've only used those review powers twice, once into a number of public sector organisations looking at the issue of public sector procurement, and then latterly in my final year of commissioner, working with the Welsh Government to look at, I suppose the review question being how well is the machinery of government embedding the requirements of the Wellbeing of Future Generations Act. And that was interesting because we essentially did that collaboratively with the Welsh Government, which is not usually how these reviews start to happen. We had you know, quite a long process of building sort of trust. Some of that was very bumpy along the way, because as you can imagine, government doesn't necessarily like an external organisation or commissioner coming in looking at the ins and outs of how they're taking decisions. But we actually found that process incredibly useful, and I think the Welsh Government even found that process incredibly useful. I feel that we were able to push them more into the space of really critically reflecting, you know, where things were working and where things weren't. And actually, you know, what we did at the end of that was to develop a jointly constructed or a jointly developed improvement plan for areas which they could, well, for areas that they could improve on implementing the Future Generations Act. But I think the main point for me is that that is quite difficult for governments to do. It's quite difficult to be in that space. And that doesn't necessarily create a healthy environment for good public policy making.
Well, thank you very much for that. Just to finish off with yourself, Professor Flinders, since you were cut off in your prime, as it were, throughout all of this conversation, there's a theme running around maturity, whether it's regard how we deal with risk and innovation or complexity or power. Have you got any final reflections on all of what you've heard thus far? Because I suppose this is a kind of academic side of decision making. Just any final thoughts, if you could. Thanks.
I think following on from Sophie, what is interesting is that ministers and officials are often very open to having these questions about complexity and challenge. But they will have those discussions off stage, very mature, very open discussions. But when they become on stage in front of committees or the media, then we tend to lock everything down in a very immature way. So one of the thoughts I've had really is, how do you move those more mature offstage conversations about the inevitable messiness of policymaking and how to learn from failure? How do you move them on stage in a way that might promote a much more sensible culture and understanding of the inevitable challenges of policymaking?
Any ideas, bright ideas on that then?
Well, I think there are issues around policy advice. I mean, if you look at accountability in government, accountability for the policy advice given to ministers is generally still kept in the black box. It's kept off stage. If there were a process where some level of accountability was introduced for the basic advice given to ministers, not only, I think, would that demand that officials really lifted the quality of that advice, because they knew they would be held to account for it in the future, it would also provide a firmer foundation on which to say to ministers, explain your decision. But again, one of the knock-on here is one of the great issues we have about accountability and expertise is the amount of churn and turnover amongst civil servants and officials. A fluid system, which means that just as somebody gets on top of a role, develops the informal relationships and trust to really understand their specialist policy space, they move on. And the whole process starts again. So greater stability, greater maturity around publishing some level of the policy advice ministers received, and an obligation on the media and scrutineers to fulfil their side of the bargain, which isn't to jump in with both feet, going for the low-hanging attack fruit, but for them to accept themselves that these are complex issues where there aren't any silver bullets and simple solutions to complex problems.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much for that. I'm laughing slightly, given that we're operating in a political environment. So thank you very much for that input, though. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Come to Douglas Lumsden, please.
Thanks, Convener. It's actually just building on the point that Michelle Thompson was making, and it's around transparency. And Professor Flinders, you have in your submission, you talk about transparency in two different ways, the transparency of the decision-making process and the transparency around the reason why a final decision was taken. And I think that's what you were just talking about just now. And in our previous evidence sessions, we've heard, you know, I think in New Zealand, Cabinet meeting minutes are published, I think, a few weeks after the meeting takes place. I'm trying to get, from your point of view, would that be a good thing? Or do you think that would almost drive some of the decision-making? We've heard WhatsApp by, you know, government by WhatsApp mentioned in previous meetings as well. Do you think that would drive a lot of the decisions away from cabinet meetings if it's almost too transparent?
No, I think, again, it's about policy making is all about pragmatism. And of course, anything you do, there will be unintended consequences and a degree of gaming. And of course, we are working in both a big P and a small P political context. However, I think that by publishing a statement of the policy advice ministers received, and also a statement from ministers, it doesn't have to be, I'm not talking about a detailed exposition, but some statement of the standard of policy advice received by ministers and an explanation by ministers for why they took a particular decision they did, particularly when they go against the advice they received, would provide more of a firm foundation for a mature discussion to take place. And I think what's interesting about this, and New Zealand is an interesting, but it's always the obvious example everyone goes to. New Zealand is a very small country. As you'll know, it's on the other side of the world. It's got working on a much smaller scale, and it also has a different political culture. And I think going back to the previous question, that is what I'm talking about, is that if you really want effective Scottish decision-making where everybody can make a contribution in an honest way with candour, it has to accept that everybody won't get what they want all of the time and that it will still be messy. But I think the question for me is transparency in terms of the quality of policy advice ministers receive, and then some post-decisional explanation for why they took that decision. Because then at least you've got a lot firmer foundation for sensible scrutiny, where at the moment almost everybody works in a vacuum. And I do think it would improve potentially the quality of advice coming through to ministers. That again, just creating that knowledge amongst officials that the advice they give will at some point be subject to public review and discussion, will again help them, support them to lift the quality and arguably the range of advice they provide to ministers.
And you don't think there's a danger of some of that decisions obviously being taken behind closed doors and done in different ways?
Well, I suppose at the moment we might say that all of the decisions and everything is done behind closed doors. And we have very little. So that's what I'm saying. It's like a halfway house. I mean, if you look back, people used to say the same about the Freedom of Information Act. That, and again, New Zealand was a model there, that what we would have was government by post-it, that people would not write stuff down in official documents. And actually, that hasn't really happened. And I think what's interesting is, again, long-termism. that often things that happen are seen as quite radical at first, but then they become accepted parts of due process and almost the system matures around them. My concern is that if you were to start to introduce some of these issues around the publication of policy advice, in the short term, it would likely to fall in a political context that was very immature and would be problematic. But I would hope in the medium to longer term, that innovation would settle down and would just be seen as part of due process. And people would then, in not long, say, I can't believe this ever wasn't the way we did things.
Thank you. And Sophie and Steve, do you have a view on transparency and decisions that were taken?
Yeah, I mean, I think I take a slightly different view to Matt, and I perhaps to just give a little bit of context, I have, you know, been worked in government with politicians and the First Minister and Cabinet prior, a number of years prior to being Future Generations Commissioner. So I'm actually of the view that that would drive people to not express the full picture in terms of the full range of evidence and insight that they might otherwise take, because they would feel that it's not a safe space to do that. And on the one hand, I agree, in an ideal world, I totally agree with Matt that you would want that sort of that transparency. On the other hand, we are, you know, operating in the world of, you know, political reality. And I'm not convinced about the FOI point. I'm, you know, saying I don't have any evidence to prove or disprove this, but I'm guessing the issue is on FOI, we don't know what we don't know. We don't know how much is only being recorded as a bare minimum as a result of FOI. And my feeling is that in terms of government policy making, I'm not sure that that would drive civil servants to do a really kind of comprehensive approach. I think it would drive them back to the bare minimum. I think that it's certainly in the short term, a more fruitful exercise would be to really focus on building that internal challenge within the system. So I do agree with Matt that there are problems around the churn in the system and the level of expertise. Most civil servants, by the very nature of the way the civil service operates, are generalists and move between different policy departments. And I think that there can sometimes be a reluctance to bring in external expertise to work with alongside civil servants on particular policy areas. Now, where we've seen that happen, I think that we've seen better policy making. And I can give an example of violence against women bill that was passed in the by the Senedd a few years ago, where civil servants who were generalists were working alongside experts from the field who were seconded into government for that sort of period of taking that that bill through the parliament, doing the sort of policy development and so on. And I think that that is perhaps a safer way in the short term of building in that kind of expertise. I think the other area is creating some safe space around internal challenge. So some of the things that we were trying to do as part of the Section 20 review was to say, okay, let's have a look at a number of ministerial submissions and let's critique those in a safe space so that we can, you know, explain perhaps or help officials who are filling in those submissions to understand how that could have been done better from the perspective of using future trends, or from the perspective of looking in an integrated way, or from the perspective of involving citizens. And there was quite a reluctance to do that, to have that kind of safe, you know, even though I would say that we were in a space of safe external challenge. I think if we could build that in somehow, that would be quite fruitful. And then the final element that I just want to talk about there is the role and expertise of more senior civil servants in providing that challenge themselves. So I'm assuming it's a similar process in terms of the Scottish Government, but in Wales, you know, policy development will often start from, either from a minister or from a particular pressure from outside. Officials will be looking at, what policy can be developed and so on. And then when submissions go up, to the minister, a more senior civil servant will consider that submission. Now, that comes back to the question, how skilled is that senior civil servant, or perhaps in some cases, a group of senior civil servants, in actually really critiquing that from the perspective, I would say, of the Wellbeing of Future Generations Act and those five ways of working? Is there work to do there with those senior officials? And even if they've done a really good job in critiquing it, how well is that used then as a learning exercise for civil servants who are in their policy development role, saying, OK, this is where we could have done better. This was done really well. We'll share this elsewhere. Here's the learning from this and so on. And I'm just not convinced that that happens effectively enough. But I would say in the early phases, and, I would very much like to get to the point where, we had what Matt describes, but done in a way which is being done genuinely rather than box ticking. I would like to get there. But I think in the early phases, I think really it's about improving the internal culture mechanism and safe space for external people to come inside and challenge.
Okay. Thank you. Steve, do you have anything to add on transparency or...?
Very briefly, one additional thought. I'm agnostic on Matt's proposal, but I think it's entirely legitimate for you as scrutineers, for the public, for the media, to require policymakers to explain the evidence base which is behind the decisions which they make. Or if it's not an evidence-based decision, to explain that too. Evidence is only part of the policy process, of course. Ministers have a democratic mandate and they can decide to implement whatever it is that they feel it's right to implement. But I do think sometimes there's a lack of inquiry into on what basis has this decision been made, whether that's about what to do or how to do it, as we were saying earlier. And I think that mature questioning of, have you looked at the evidence? What's your take on what the evidence says? Would be a really helpful injection into our policymaking process. And it would at least make more transparent the basis on which the decision was made, not necessarily the process by which it was made.
Okay. Thanks, Camilla.
Thanks. So the points that you're all making about accountability provokes in my mind some questions about the role of private sector consultancy companies. Which are obviously involved in I think, in all governments in the UK in terms of policy advice, policy development. I just wondered if we had any reflections on the role that you have seen those organisations play and how they are involved in the decision-making processes. Maybe come to Matt Flinders first, please.
I think the private sector consultancies do play a key role. I think they're often brought in almost to provide expertise and specialist knowledge which the more generalist civil servants may not have. I think for me the key issue is almost part of the culture very often is that for some reason the private sector consultants know best and know exactly what should be done. And actually, I think often they're bringing in very private sector based ideologies and models, which might improve and have some element of challenge. But I think the idea that the public sector consultancies always know best is problematic. And I'm not sure always, I mean, I think when we're talking about decision making in policy, we're talking about decisions at the very highest level. I think my understanding is that the consultancies are more involved in the fine-tuning of operational issues, organisational structures, management, things like that, rather than the top end of the sort of minister, senior official, special advisor interface, which we are talking about how do we make sure they understand what effectiveness might, does, could look like. But on that, I'll hand over to one of the other witnesses.
There was a Conservative minister quoted in 2020 saying that Whitehall had been infantilised by the use of consultancy companies, and kind of reflected on your point of where they're positioned almost in the policy-making chain. I thought that was highly critical at that point. But yeah, I'll draw... Steve Martin is on the screen. So,
I worked a lot with the UK government 15, 20 years ago, and it seems to me there is a contrast between the use of public sector consultants by UK government and, say, the Welsh government, which I'm now much more familiar with. For me, I think in part it's a reflection of civil service policy-making capacity, which is a serious issue which we need to address over the short to medium term. And we are often asked now to take on roles which I kind of feel, if the civil service was fully up to capacity and was given the capabilities that it really should have, they wouldn't be coming to us asking us to do some of the work that we're asked to do. So I do think some of this is about gap filling as well as kind of opportunism on the behalf of private sector consultants. And I think that directs our attention to understanding what the capacity and capability of the civil service and local government and other policy actors currently is. And every time we have some form of engagement, we're reminded that we're in a state of permanent crisis, that it might be very nice to be able to analyse the evidence in a measured way, but that's not the world we're operating in, Steve. And that to me talks to being realistic about policy ambition. So can we actually do everything that we would ideally like to do, or do some of our strategies and policy ambitions outstrip our current capacity? So rather than questioning too much whether private consultancies are the right or the wrong vehicle, I think I prefer us to turn our attention to how do we develop the capability and capacity within the system to deliver what ministers want.
I don't know if you're aware of, there's a fairly recent book from Mariana Mazzucato and Rosie Collingham on this particular area and the role in government, and they say that the more government outsource, the less they know how to do. Does that ring true to you?
Based on our own experience, and both Sophie and Matt were talking about finding ways to bring in external expertise, I wouldn't formulate it quite that way. Certainly, if you outsource policymaking to the big four consultancies all the time, of course that's going to happen. But the co-production principles that Sophie was talking about, I think, enrich policymaking. So if you're taking different forms of evidence from different forms of actor, I think that greatly enhances the chances of you being able to deliver on the policy that you're trying to enact. So involving local government, involving the voluntary sector, involving users of services, women who have lived experience of domestic violence, as Sophie was saying, but also involving academic expertise. There really is a wealth of expertise and research in our universities, and my personal mission is to help policymakers to tap into that much more easily and much more accessibly.
Okay, thank you. Sophie Howe, do you have thoughts in this area?
Yes, I agree with both Matt and Steve. I think in terms of external consultants, particularly the sort of big four that Steve was talking about, I don't think our experiences in Wales reflect the Whitehall experience, and I agree, I wouldn't quite describe it as Mariana Mazzucato has described it either. I think that we have a much stronger approach around co-production with the sorts of groups that that Steve was outlining there. And increasingly, I think we're seeing them not just be a ministerial advisory group that's sort of set up slightly outside of government, but we're increasingly seeing them being brought into the civil service. I talked about the Violence Against Women Bill, but another good example is the Social Partnership and Procurement Bill, which is currently going through the Senedd, and that has trade union. This is about social partnership between trade unions, private sector and government, and putting that on a statutory footing. And trade unionists were actually seconded into government to help with the policy development around that. Now, I think that that is, you know, a good model, and I think we see better policy making come from that. I think that just going back to the point that Steve was making on the sort of the pace of being able to provide evidence and so on, I think sometimes what politicians want to do is to just borrow your brain. They don't necessarily want you to spend 5 months, you know, crafting all of the evidence and so on. That, I completely agree, would be absolutely ideal. But they are continually responding in this now, you know, this new word, polycrisis. And they are trying to respond on all different fronts. And they're often trying to respond very, very quickly because there's a necessity to real lives out there to respond quickly. And there's also political pressures and so on. So I actually think that there's something around, you know, how can you convene experts who can, in a safe space, who can have conversations with ministers and with civil servants to say, you know, within the context, these are my boundaries. You know, I'm only going to get this amount of money. This is the political reality that I'm working with. This is the scale and pace at which I need to deliver. What is, you know, borrowing your brains, what helped me craft the best possible solution within those boundaries? And I think it's those sorts of things that ministers actually want. I think that's why they often rely very heavily on their special advisors and sort of trusted networks, if you like, from perhaps their own backgrounds or professions or contacts that they might have developed throughout their career. And I think that there's something about us recognising that and the system as a whole responding to that. The final thing that I sort of wanted to say about trying to develop that internal capability and capacity. I think that there's certainly something around secondments into government. I mentioned a few there, but I think if there was one thing that we could do to drive better policy making, you know, across the whole public sector, it would probably be mass job swap or secondment. So, you know, you do have the social worker who's in policing, or you do have the green infrastructure expert who's in, you know, working in health or those sorts of things. And actually, I think there's something there around that cross fertilisation, which needs to be encouraged in government and isn't very often actually encouraged. There was something that our former permanent secretary, Sian Morgan, did, which was a small intervention, but I think was, and I'm not sure actually if it's still continuing, but I think it was quite good. It was called STEP. It stood for Short Term Experience Placement. And this was where civil servants were given time to go out into an organisation outside of government for up to 6 months, and it could be a day a week, or it could be, you know, a sort of a month placement or whatever whatever it might be. And there were some really interesting things that came from that. I mean, one of the things that I can point to is someone who came from the major events division or department in government into my team. And OK, we're now sort of 2 years later, or possibly even 3 years after the pandemic. But actually, there is now a major events strategy in Wales, which is built around the Wellbeing of Future Generations Act. And that's because that civil servant was immersed in a team that was giving her a completely different perspective to what she would get perhaps internally. So I think there are these innovative ways of trying to shake up the system and build that expertise in. I think there's just something about civil servants are so busy managing crises, and even senior civil servants, of course, are managing those crises. There needs to be some capacity in the system for people to lift their heads up and say, OK, what are these potential things that we could do, which in the long medium, and some of it I think actually is even short medium and certainly longer term, is going to help us to craft better responses when we're in this constant state of crisis.
OK, thanks, Sophie. Steve Martin, you wanted to come back in.
Thank you. Really brief. I like Sophie's concept of borrowing your brain, and that's certainly been our experience, that ministers and officials really welcome the opportunity for dialogue. And more usually for us, it's about borrowing a number of different brains. So I'm an academic. When I started in this role 10 years ago, I envisaged we'd be writing reports and perhaps there'd be a summary or a policy briefing alongside it. What we found really rapidly was probably the most useful thing that we do is convene safe spaces, round tables, where experts come together with officials and sometimes with ministers to really talk through an issue over a couple of hours. And it's not a case of just throwing those people together. We structure those really carefully. We pick the experts who have a range of complementary experiences and expertises to bring to a, because it's very rare to find a kind of Renaissance woman or man who has all the answers. So bringing together a group of experts to really work through what the evidence suggests and how that evidence might apply or not in Wales has probably been the most fruitful thing that we've done if we listen to the feedback that we get. And that doesn't need to take 5 months. That can be done in 2 or 3 weeks. But I think you need an intermediary there because academic colleagues, even the most confident, are wary about coming into those sorts of fora and need to be helped to understand how the expertise they bring is really going to be relevant.
Okay. Mark Flinders, you wanted to come in?
Yes, very briefly. I'm taken with this issue around mobility and short-term placements. If you look at what I would say world-class policy-making structures, they are often defined by a capacity to facilitate mobility, the mobility of people and talent and knowledge across traditional institutional and professional boundaries. And I really think that that emphasis on facilitating the flow and mobility of people, learning and different environments, putting up linkages, both formal and informal, is really, really important. And there's a great example of this in Scotland with the Scottish Crucible. The Scottish Crucible is all about innovative thinking, bringing people from different backgrounds together that would not normally meet. And I think it is those, how do you create structured serendipity which allows ideas, linkages and perspectives to emerge that wouldn't normally take place in siloed traditional environments.
Okay, thanks, Matt. John Mason.
Hey, thanks very much, convener. Maybe to continue the theme of who does what, I'm interested in the concept of commissioners. And I think also we'll start with yourself, Ms Howe, perhaps. You personally, your position has been held in quite high regard and there's been quite a thought in Scotland that we should be copying the Welsh model of having a commissioner for future generations or something like that. But at the same time, there's a kind of multiplicity of commissioners being desired in Scotland. And I can see us ending up with 14 or perhaps more in the short term. So I just wonder, where do commissioners fit into this whole thing of decision making? Are they basically taking work away that the MSs should be doing?
I'll speak to my own experiences and perhaps some of the interactions that I've had with commissioner colleagues, children's commissioner, older people's commissioner and Welsh language commissioner in Wales. I think that yes, we are providing scrutiny. I think that certainly from my perspective, if you look at the Future Generations Act, it covers all policy areas, potentially every decision that could be taken for anyone who's alive now and anyone yet to be born. So obviously that's a huge kind of remit. But what that, and I couldn't look at every particular issue, but what that did enable me to do is to have a helicopter view, if you like, over policy making at a government level and across government departments, but also how that policy making then flowed down through into the rest of the public sector. And I often think about something like the Future Generations Act being a bit like, when we talk about mainstreaming equality or mainstreaming gender or those sorts of things. And the overall aim that you want to get to, I suppose, proposes that commissioners aren't needed and that level of intensive scrutiny and specific scrutiny isn't needed, because what we're trying to achieve in this case, ensuring that we're taking in decisions in a way which meets today's needs without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs, that is completely embedded in the system. But everything we've heard this morning points to all of the challenges, and everything I'm sure you've heard throughout all of the evidence you've taken points to the really specific challenges and really significant challenges in actually doing that. So in terms of the role of a commissioner, perhaps I could just give you a flavour of perhaps some of the things that my sort of day-to-day interactions look like. It was about sometimes taking the time out and commissioning my own research and convening people and experts to put forward what I would say are sort of progressive policy ideas to government, a number of which actually have been taken up, some of which perhaps would not be considered as something that were at all possible. For example, a first pilot of a basic income was not on the kind of political agenda at all just a few years ago, and we're now seeing the first pilot in Wales, and that was a lot of my work with others in communities and in NGOs and third sector and so on. I would often be looking at particular policy areas and making the connections with other organisations, and I spent an inordinate amount of time introducing civil servants to each other in different departments, which you wouldn't think necessarily was the role of a Future Generations Commissioner, but when you've got that requirement around long-term preventative and integrated policy making, and I think Matt's example at the beginning around homelessness is a really good example of that. What we still see is that kind of siloed decision making, trying to do a short term fix rather than looking at a long term view. And so a lot of what I was doing was working directly with civil servants to try and join up the dots between different aspects of public policy making and asking them how they were applying the Future Generations Act and holding their hand in many cases to apply the Future Generations Act. I suppose the other issues that I was involved in was really trying to provide that link to what was happening outside of government on those policy areas. So sometimes with the private sector, the voluntary sector and so on, to bring again that kind of integration to it. And then the other areas that we were really heavily involved in was building capacity and capability amongst the civil servants and civil service around applying foresight, long-term trends, future generations thinking and so on, which they, was an entirely new thing to them when the Future Generations Act came into force. So to the role of commissioners, would any of that have happened if there wasn't a commissioner? I don't know. Of course, I can't say for certain, but I'm not at all convinced that it would if there is not an institution, be it a commission, a commissioner, however you want to sort of, term it or set it up, that was whose primary role was to do that and had some legislative mandate to directly work with government and others to do that.
Okay, thanks. That's very helpful. I'll come to Professor Flinders just in a minute, but if I can press you on this, you've mentioned short-term and long-term quite a lot of times in your answer there, and I just wondered, do you think it's impossible for politicians and civil servants to take a long-term view unless there's somebody outside kicking them?
Well, first of all, I'm not sure that I would use the term kicking. I think I would use the term working alongside, enhancing capability, helping with learning and development and so on in those areas. But to your point on, is it impossible? Of course, nothing is impossible, but I think it's very, very difficult when the system itself is continually in a state of crisis and is continually being asked to respond. So without an external challenge and support to require the system to lift its head above the polycrisis that it's in continually, I do think it's incredibly difficult.
Thanks very much. That's been very good. Professor Flinders, I saw you nodding at one point there. This idea of the long term, do we need commissioners for that?
Well, I would use the word nudging rather than kicking, and I think commissioners can be very, very useful in terms of nudging and creating that sort of oversight. And I think it relates back to an issue we discussed earlier, which is about the big P politics here. One of the benefits of having an independent commissioner is that they can come to topics, issues, challenges with slightly less heat than might be expected if the issue was being examined by a parliamentary scrutiny committee. We do have similar issues, of course, at Westminster, where in recent years we've had a rather ad hoc growth in the number of different commissions and commissioners, and this creates an onward a cycle of reviewing how many we've got and whether we should get rid of them, merge them, amalgamate them. But in terms of their capacity, I think particularly for policy, because they do have, they're almost slightly depoliticised, I think they have a good role to play in nudging sensible discussions, review and integrating. And just one little issue that was raised there by Sophie is just, and I'm sorry if I'm telling people stuff they're well aware of, the amount of fragmentation and disconnection in government is incredible. I often have officials from Whitehall contact me in Sheffield to ask me what's going on in different directorates of their own department. So this simple role of joining up and introducing people to let people know what's going on is an absolutely key role. You'd think it wouldn't be needed, but that integrating role that a commissioner can play or an organisation like the Wales Centre for Public Policy is absolutely crucial.
Okay, thanks. Professor Martin?
To move to the next question, I don't have much to add to that discussion, except to agree with everything that my colleagues have said. And we have exactly the same experience. Sometimes I think my function is to introduce civil servants to each other or to remind them of the initiative which their predecessor undertook. So that organisational memory role is something which I think that we and commissioners can helpfully provide.
Okay, thanks. So maybe for yourself then, I mean, I'm interested in the Centre for Public Policy that Wales has, and it's been spoken of quite positively by other witnesses, and therefore, I mean, the question for Scotland is do we need something like that? I mean, I get the impression, and correct me if I'm wrong, that in Scotland we have a kind of ad hoc relationship between, I think, government, parliament and academia, and we bring people in for a particular issue and then kind of don't speak to them again for a while. Is it the case, as I imagine it is in Wales, that there's just a better relationship between government and the universities and academics, and that that's therefore a kind of longer term relationship?
I think that there was certainly a relationship similar to the one that you're describing 10 years ago, where different parts of government and local government and health and others had their own links to research centres or individual academics within Welsh universities. And I had the experience of often being contacted about issues about which I knew next to nothing, just because I was a professor of public policy in Cardiff and civil servants knew me. What we've tried to do is to open up the policy-making process here to a much broader range of different kinds of evidence. So evidence not just in Welsh universities, but from across the UK and internationally. I think when we first started, some of my colleagues thought, oh, this is great, we'll be able to have even more interaction with Welsh Government through the Wales Centre for Public Policy. And they've been slightly disappointed to find that most of the time we're drawing in expertise from much further afield. So I think one of the differences between what we do and the relationship you're describing is that much wider world of evidence which we're trying to draw in. Secondly, I think there's a danger in the ad hocery that certain kinds of voices get privileged, that people know me, so they come to me. There are many other sources of expertise and advice which don't get taken into account because they're not known and they don't have those kind of pre-existing links. So taking a more systematic approach, which involves scanning the horizon for who are the experts in this field and what can they bring to the table, I think has been a really helpful part of what we've tried to do. And then thirdly, we find that there are parts of government which are well served by evidence and other parts which are largely evidence-free zones. And a lot of what we've tried to do in the last few years is to provide evidence to those directorates, those departments on those policy issues where there hasn't been a strong evidence base in the past. So in very broad terms, health policy is often underpinned by evidence. Education policy is reasonably well served by both the Welsh Government's internal research function and relationships with universities here in Wales. But there are other areas like housing, like net zero, like tackling poverty, which haven't historically had those links to good, reliable source of evidence. So I recognise the picture which you're describing in Scotland. I think that would be a good description of how we were 10 years ago. But I think having the infrastructure of evidence intermediaries who can help define what's needed through discussion with policymakers in the way I was describing earlier, and then go out and seek sources of advice and evidence which specifically address that particular evidence need is a different ballgame to depending on existing links or serendipity or who knows who. And Matt referred earlier to the very big investment there's now been in evidence infrastructures of different kinds here in Wales, but across the UK as well. And I'd be concerned that if you don't have something in a similar role to ours, you might be missing out on some of those sources of evidence out with Scotland, which you might want to be tapping into in spite of the political differences and the need to navigate those. So there's a What Works network, 13 What Works centres, which we're part of. We provide Wales with a strong link into those other What Works centres, looking at things like educational attainment, regeneration, early intervention, children's social care, higher education policy. At the moment, Scotland doesn't have that link into that network, and I suspect that's a missed opportunity.
Okay, that's all extremely helpful. Thanks so much, Kev. I can just ask you one final question. You talked about the round tables earlier and how they were safe spaces. Does what happens there get recorded or published or a summary of it, or how does that work?
Yeah, exactly as you described. So we want it to be a safe space where people can ask the questions that they want to ask, but we also want to make sure that it's not a secret space. So we publish our work programme in advance so opposition parties and others can understand what it is that we're working on behalf of ministers. And then we publish key findings from something like a workshop or a round table so that the evidence is available to everybody without identifying who said what and who's asked what. So those all happen under a sort of Chatham House rule. But the key evidence points to emerge from and the advice are made available to the whole world. And they will probably be FOI-able if we didn't, but we choose to do it anyway. We think it's a good thing to do.
OK, that's great. Thanks so much. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Mr Mason. I'm the Convener. And I'd like to thank all our witnesses for taking the time to speak to committee today. It's invaluable evidence, and thank you for joining us. With the agreement of committee, we'll move rejig the agenda slightly and move to item 4, which we'll take in private. And the public session of committee will reconvene at 11 a.m. For evidence from the Minister. In agreement?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thanks again to our witnesses. Thank you, colleagues. I move to agenda item 3, which is an evidence session on the financial memorandum to the Children, Care and Justice Scotland Bill. And a welcome to the meeting, Natalie Dawn, MSP, Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise, who is joined by Scottish Government officials, Brendan Rooney, Bill Manager, Tom McNamara, Head of Youth, Justice and Children's Hearings, and Helen Duncan from the Children and Families Analysis. Thank you all for coming today. Welcome to the meeting. And I would invite Natalie Dawn to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, members. The fundamental principles this bill takes forward are as follows. Where children come into contact with care and justice services or into conflict with the law, Scotland must respond appropriately, and this should happen in age-appropriate systems and settings. Our obligations under the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child and commitment to keep the promise are clear on these points, and those commitments benefit from cross-party endorsement in this Parliament. The bill takes forward important measures to improve experiences and outcomes for children in Scotland, especially those who need extra care and support. The bill builds on our Getting It Right for Every Child principles and youth justice vision. By helping to address the causes of a child's offending behaviours, we can assist them to desist and to rehabilitate, and in turn we can prevent further harm and minimise the number of future victims. In doing so, we can help to improve outcomes for everyone in society. In terms of public expenditure, it is important to recognise the wider backdrop of the benefits that these change programmes are advancing. The negative cost to society, both economic and social, of offending and crime, both at the time and to the future, are well documented. So, for example, the Promise Follow the Money report estimated the cumulative private costs of physical and emotional harm, lost output and public service costs to be £3.9 billion. So by investing in services that take an early intervention approach, we can lead to more positive pathways more often for individuals and communities. And we're coming from a strong baseline. Between 2008 to 2009 and 2019 to 20, there was an 85% reduction in the number of children and young people prosecuted in Scotland's courts, and a 93% reduction in 16 and 17-year-olds being sentenced to custody. Whilst the government is not complacent and recognises there will always be a level of offending and a requirement for care and protection in any society, this bill represents a solid step forward. In terms of the costs, the government has engaged widely on forecasts. In addition to our full public consultation, extensive engagement has also taken place with a host of partners and stakeholders. The cost forecasts in the financial memorandum are based on the feedback and figures provided from that engagement. I am aware that the Stage 1 process has brought some helpful additional detail and updated information to light, and that is part of the legislative process, and we absolutely welcome it. The government is alert to the need to ensure forecasts can be refreshed and as up to date as possible. That's why the multi-agency resourcing and implementation group, which starts meeting next month, will be crucial to our preparations. We will work with partners to explore individual and combined resource requirements in more depth and report any necessary updates or clarifications to this Parliament. This work will feed into budget profiles for next year and the years beyond, as is the established process for financial planning regarding proposed legislation. And we are, of course, mindful that parliamentary agreement is required and therefore will keep projections refreshed as the bill moves forward and is amended through scrutiny. The issue of secure care funding has been a key topic in Stage 1 scrutiny. We have had a last bed pilot running in each of the four independent secure centres, and we are exploring extending that exercise towards funding up to 16 secure beds during 23-24, so that sufficient capacity will stand ready should the bill be passed. We are also looking closely at the appropriate mechanisms for funding remand costs and will update when we have concluded that work. We welcome the additional insight and precision emerging from the Stage 1 process at various committees in the Parliament. It's integral to producing the best possible quality in our legislative output. I hope these opening remarks have been helpful, and I look forward to taking your questions.
Thank you, Minister. Can I ask when Parliament might see a revised financial memorandum on the basis that you've described?
I don't have a date for that at the moment. Obviously, I said that the working group will start. It's got a meeting scheduled on the 5th of June, and obviously stage one needs to be completed before that can happen. So everything that we've heard from committees and stakeholders so far will feed into that, but I don't have a finalised date for that at the moment.
So prior to the completion of stage one? I've revised.
No, stage one will feed into that, so it would be following that.
Following stage one. Okay. And can I ask on your point regarding the last bed policy and putting that in place for 23-24, is the funding continuing at the moment, or has it expired for the policy?
So it expired at the end of March 2023, and we are looking to expand and increase on that now.
So the secure accommodation don't have the funding in place at the moment?
Not just now, but it would be for the full financial year, so that wouldn't be an issue for secure care centres at the current moment in time.
Okay, we can check that. Okay, Michelle Thompson.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister, for attending. I mean, obviously, we're all pleased to hear about the updated FM, and in our scrutiny of the FM and the kind of processes around what happens with money and costs and all the rest of it, I'm sure we all agree as to the worthiness of the bill, but our specific focus will always be on the money and the spend. And obviously you've indicated yourself the level of uncertainty as to the estimates that were put in place originally. But I suppose I wanted to explore with you how you see the scale of the challenge going forward, given that we know there are multiple areas of various sections excluded from the original FM with no estimates at all. Plus, we've got the group you mentioned. Sorry, I forgot the name you used for it. How are you going to be able to assure yourself that all costs are included, albeit in estimate form, and two, that they've taken account for what is now a very high inflationary and cost environment? And so critically, I suppose the question I'm probing is, to what extent will that be given the full weight it deserves alongside the undoubted kind of enthusiasm for what is some very strong policies?
So that's a really important question, and I understand the committee's concerns around that. Obviously, the financial memo was completed well prior to my time in office, but it was completed, as the member has rightly pointed out, prior to some wider issues such as inflation. The financial memo was completed with, as I've said, contribution of stakeholders and organisations, so it was a good starting point, a good snapshot in time of what the costs were at that point. However, going forward, as we've rightly said, that does need to be updated, but we are confident that we can fulfil that. The multi-agency meeting, sorry, that I referred to in my opening statement, that will be meeting on the 5th of June, and that will take these discussions forward with the appropriate stakeholders and appropriate organisations. And based on the feedback that we have already received or heard at this stage, so that's going to be very helpful. In terms of those sort of longer constraints, I think it's really important to recognise the wider backdrop that these benefits and these change programmes could have, and the potential savings that they're going to have to public expenditure. So the negative cost to society, both economic and social, of offending and crime, they're well documented. So, for example, the Promise Follow the Money report estimated that the cumulative costs for physical and emotional harm, lost output and public service costs equated to £3.9 billion. So that is going to be something that we need to look at in terms of the savings that this will have in the longer term.
Yeah, and I suppose I don't disagree with you about any of the principles. The devil will be in the details. So I suppose what I'm looking for are your assurances that the multi-agency meetings will put an equivalent level of attention to both the costs and, as you outline, the savings, as they will to driving forward the policy itself, because the last thing you would want to see is a new minister in post. And of course, I appreciate you're talking about something over which you had no say, but the last thing I want to see is that you as a new minister are then subjected to considerable cost overruns, because some of the things that are missing out of the FM, the reason they're missing is because they're complex and difficult, where you also don't have policy detail. So I suppose I'm simply looking for assurances to you that some people think the funding is kind of quite dull compared to the policy, but if you think that, you're taking a risk, and I wouldn't want to see you do that. So I'm just simply looking for your assurances that you will pass that on to your people that are supporting you.
Absolutely. It's a priority for us to get this right, because we want this to be implemented appropriately. As I said, the financial memorandum was a snapshot in time. The committee evidence and the scrutiny will feed into that and will direct and help to input on the conversations had going forward in terms of the finances that are needed. And we will also continue to press the UK government for additional funding for joint priorities, and would welcome support from across the Parliament, COSLA and other individual local authorities in this respect. But please, I would like to ensure the committee that this is absolutely a priority for us and something that we are well tuned into.
A point of clarity then, the updated memorandum will take account of pay inflation. There'll be some reference in terms of the increased demands, will there?
Well, as far as I'm aware, it will take part in heed of inflation, but I will just pass over to one of my officials to clarify that for me.
There we go. Thanks. Yes, it will be updated for inflation. So the figures in the financial memorandum as they stand took us up to 22-23. But obviously we recognise that inflation has changed quite a lot since then. And we will be updating for that as we go forward.
And the memorandum, and thank you for that, the memorandum as it stands appears to indicate that the calculations for social work resource are based on a social worker working 35 hours a week, 52 weeks a year. Are we going to see that formula rejigged? That's part of the criticism that came from COSLA and Social Work Scotland.
So again, I understand there have been some concerns raised around the funding for social work. Again, I would just like to reiterate that these figures were worked out in conjunction with various different organisations, Social Work Scotland being one of them. But we absolutely value the work of our social workers and want to ensure that their engagement continues throughout this. They will be involved in the group that I'm discussing on the 5th of June. In terms of those intricate details, I'll pass back over to Helen.
Yes, I am aware of the section of the feedback from COSLA that you are referring to. I think that there was maybe... they're coming out from a slightly different point of view from us. So what we have done there is work out sort of indicative cost of an average hour of a social worker's time. So that's why we're using the kind of full time, like number of hours worked in a week and number of weeks of the year. There's some criticism from COSLA about the weeks of annual leave within that year.
As well.
Yes, so they have to pay for holidays as well. So that would be reflected in the cost to their employer. So it is reasonable to use all of the hours across the year that the social worker is paid for. So that's why we've used those figures. But of course, we would be engaging further with COSLA on that. So if they...
Okay, that's reassuring. And my last point of clarity on this then, on the memorandum recognises demand for aftercare, but doesn't allocate any resource for aftercare. You'll look again at that?
Yep. Again, it's difficult to quantify that looking ahead, as with many things, as has already been alluded to within this bill. Again, that's something that will be looked at.
Okay, that's good. Douglas.
Convener. Minister, what assurances can you give local government that they won't be impacted financially by this bill?
Again, it kind of comes back to what I've already been saying. COSLA were involved in the discussions in relation to the financial memo and the creation of the financial memo itself. However, I understand now have raised some specific concerns around that funding.
Again, the COSLA are going to be feeding into the working group of the 5th of June, and this is something that we are going to be working through and discussing with them and engaging with them. So those reassurances, will come as those discussions go forward.
Right, COSLA have raised some serious concerns about, you know, what this means financially to our local authorities. So it would be good to have some assurance for them that they won't be impacted. So do you think that assurance will come out as we go through this process and they won't be impacted financially by this bill?
Yeah, as I say, we are working with local government in respect of that, and there have already been things that have came out of the bill where we see that we could have done things differently. For example, looking at the hearings and the projected number of hearings that are going to take place when creating the financial memorandum, the lower number of hearings was used to create those figures. But we do now accept that the higher figure should have been used, and that will be reflected in any updated financial forecasts. So in terms of your kind of wider point around those reassurances, I'm using that to kind of show you that we are taking cognizance of decisions that have already been made, where that could be improved, and working with local government to again ensure that this runs the way that we want it to.
So areas like skills and training that's been highlighted, will that be covered by the updated financial memorandum?
Again, that will be based on discussions that go forward in terms of the working group.
Because that is a concern that's been highlighted by local government of where they feel they will lose out financially due to this bill being brought forward.
Yeah. As I say, I've seen the comments from COSLA, and I'm aware of them. But as I say, this is something that we'll be engaging on.
Mm-hmm. And moving on to Social Work Scotland, you know, they were quite critical as well, saying does not consider that the financial memorandum sufficiently appreciates the scale and financial costs of those changes. So, as a committee, should we be alarmed by that statement from Social Work Scotland?
I think that's a point that Social Work Scotland have made, but again, I just want to reiterate that Social Work Scotland were involved in those initial discussions. As I say, that's something that's ongoing. If they now have raised these concerns, then those will be looked at and discussed as we move forward. So I appreciate those concerns.
Okay, and they will be hopefully addressed. Final point, Convener, if I may. Police Scotland and the Crown Office have noted that the legislation had potential cost implications for the organisation that are not reflected in the FM, but did not give any indication of their scale. So what I'm trying to think, what engagement was done with, like, Police Scotland, for example, and why did they not feel they could elaborate further on what the potential cost might be?
I can't necessarily give an answer as to why they feel they couldn't engage, but they were again involved in the group that was set up to establish this, and they have been engaged in those discussions going forward. In terms of, you said there had been concerns raised by the Procurator of Fiscal and Crown Service, is that correct?
Yes, that's right, yeah. They obviously noted that the legislation had potential cost implications for the organisation that are not reflected in the financial memorandum, but did not give an indication of their scale. Okay. Which I thought was quite strange that they've raised concerns, but they haven't sort of quantified it at all.
Again, it's one of those things that it can be difficult to quantify those costs going forward. However, I'll bring my official Tom in just to clarify that for me.
Yeah, it would be helpful to the committee just to add to the level of detail in terms of engagement that's been happening with those key statutory and other delivery agencies going back a number of years now. This bill has not emerged from a clear blue sky in relation to the care and justice sectors overall, very heavily influenced by Claire Lightowler's report back in 2020 and indeed the promise. So we have engaged across those sectors, yes, at the level of principle, but also at a level of operational implications and trying to quantify what the demand might be, in particular with reference to Police Scotland and the Crown Office. We set up a bit of a rapid review group at which the Police Scotland and Crown Office were engaged, We're trying to quantify what would be the implications of displacing more children and young people in that sort of age territory away from criminal justice and into children and family services. So those discussions have informed the population of the financial memorandum and the other accompanying documents to the bill. But as the Minister said, all of those were products of their time, and we're more than ready to refresh and intensify those discussions. Perhaps to get to the heart of the matter, the point that you're raising, Mr. Lonsdon, around about that kind of quantifying part, round about what would be the extent of the unmet demand. So in order to help the Parliament and give the Minister the advice he's looking for, you know, some idea about the numbers that they were talking about there would be useful to us too.
Okay, and final point, sorry, Gmina. Social Work Scotland also noted the lack of available secure accommodation. So who would be responsible for providing that? And have you got capital budget in the financial memorandum, or will there be to try and plug that gap?
So at the moment, obviously this can fluctuate, but at the moment there is capacity in the secure care. There's currently six spaces, and there are 5 16 and 17 year olds in young offenders institutions. However, as already referred to previously, we are looking to expand the last bed policy to 16 beds, where it currently sits at 4 beds, to ensure capacity for Scottish children. That is something that is currently being discussed at ministerial level, and we do hope to provide an update on that soon. So, yes, essentially.
That will be part of the updated financial memorandum. Thank you. Thanks, Kimina.
Thank you, Douglas. Liz Smith.
Thank you. Minister, you said in your opening remarks about the fact of the initial engagement with stakeholders and that the evidence that they provided was the basis for the first attempt at a financial memorandum. You're now suggesting, obviously, that the second financial memorandum will have to take cognizance of the fact that some of that evidence was perhaps not as complete as it might have been. Could you tell us as to what you think has to be added to the second financial memorandum, given that the evidence you took for the first financial memorandum is turning out not to be accurate?
I wouldn't say it's not accurate. I would say, as I referred to earlier, it was an accurate snapshot in time of the issues and the finances that would be required at that moment. As I say, it wasn't fully based on the engagement with stakeholders, but they did help to contribute to that to a high degree. There have been things that have wider issues that have impacted on the financial memorandum itself, such as the cost of living and inflation. These are things that could not have been factored into when this was created. And obviously, as with any legislation, we need to set out the financial considerations for the bill at that present time. So I don't necessarily want to say what I think should be within the new financial memorandum. I think that will be something for the working group to discuss based on the evidence that we've heard so far and the issues that have been arisen from the first financial memorandum.
Minister, I entirely accept about cost of living issues and inflation, etc. That's absolutely accurate. But you seem to be suggesting that more information will have to come forward in order to make the second financial memorandum more accurate. Can you explain to us, I mean, if you're having this meeting on the 5th of June, can you explain to us what expectations you have of additional information that you're looking for so that this committee is more confident that the second financial memorandum is more reflective of the true costs than the first attempt?
I apologise if I've given the impression that I think more information is going to be coming forward. What I meant was the information that we have gathered from stakeholders thus far, and the information or evidence that we've heard in committees will ultimately feed into that, where stakeholders and organisations and government can come together to discuss these issues and then present a new financial or new costs going forward. So it's not that I believe there'll be any new information. It's based on the discussions and the working group that has already been going thus far. They will feed into that.
I think, Minister, I mean, no committee could expect the figures in any financial memorandum to be absolutely spot on first time round. That's a given. And Parliament experience would tell you that. We're on the back of having a look at the financial memorandum for the National Care Service, which, as you know, was found by general consensus to be very seriously lacking when it came to the first financial memorandum, and to the extent that this committee sent it back because it just wasn't good enough. If it comes to a second financial memorandum being required, by implication, that means that there will either be additional information that is forthcoming, or there will be an updated set of statistics that build on the first financial memorandum we had before. What I'm interested to know is, to what extent do you think that the meeting that you're having with stakeholders will bring forward any additional information? Because I would suggest that that's what the expectation is.
Yep. I mean, I think that will be very useful and beneficial for the updated costs. I mean, the timing for this was picked expressly to pick up on the Stage 1 committee evidence, so what I referred to in my previous answer, and to support any necessary revision and updating work ahead of Stage 2. The costs will need uprated, they will need updated, and there's no getting away from that. But as I say, I think the engagement and the evidence that we've heard so far will be the best method to prompt those discussions around that working group and the work of that going forward.
So you do expect that, given the criticism that's been levied at the bill by COSLA and various other groups, it is your expectation that at that meeting they will come forward with a carefully worded argument to the Scottish Government about what they see would need to be adjusted for an accurate reflection of the second financial memorandum? Is that your understanding?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, as I understand that they've raised this in committee evidence to other sessions, to other committees. So it would be best for them to raise it in the place where we can take action on that.
And I think, you know, this bill stands to benefit a little bit in that, as I understand it, the other committees have been looking at it. There is a general agreement that the principles are a good thing. The concern is that if we're not going to get the second financial memorandum till after Stage 1 is completed, then that raises questions about the process between Stage 1 and Stage 2. And it's our job in this committee, the Finance Committee, to make sure that that process is absolutely watertight, that between these two stages, the relevant information is put before the Parliament, because that, as I say, has been a concern for us in previous bills. So can you give us an undertaking that will happen, so that it's much more accurate on what these figures will have to be?
Given assurance that this is absolutely a priority for us, and as I said, that is why that multi-agency meeting has been scheduled for the 5th of June, and obviously without presupposing the express will of Parliament, but that has been set up so that we can get on with these discussions as soon as practically possible, because we are looking to implement, seeing the bill go through, we want to implement these changes as quickly, or not as quickly as possible, but as efficiently as possible, to the benefit of our young people, and in line with keeping the promise, and in line with keeping to the UNCRC. So I think, as I say, the fact that that meeting has been established at the beginning of June sets good stead in terms of showing the committees that this is a priority, and this is something that we'll be getting worked on as soon as Stage 1 evidence has been completed.
Okay, I understand these points in terms of reflecting what's right for children, and in terms of UNCRC, absolutely get that. What I'm concerned about, and what this committee has been concerned about with previous financial memorandum, is the process of scrutiny of the figures that go into that. That's our big concern, and has been over the period of the last couple of years with various things, and we're just trying to make sure that Parliament is absolutely watertight on that scrutiny. Thank you.
Thank you, Liz. Minister, can I ask, why do you want to see the number of cross-border placements reduced?
cross-border placement should really only be used in exceptional circumstances, and I know that other committees have heard extremely powerful evidence as to what those circumstances are. However, at the moment, the issue with cross-border placements is the fact that England simply doesn't have enough capacity for this, and this is not something that should be impacting on children in Scotland if there's no places in secure care for those.
What do you think will happen to those young people in England?
Well, that is, at the moment I can't say that. However, that is something that I know England are working on separately. My focus is obviously what we are doing in Scotland. However, I do have a meeting coming up with Claire Coutinho, the Parliamentary Undersecretary of State for Children, Families and Young People. And within that, I will be raising the matter of cross-border placements and discussing obviously what they are planning on implementing to remedy this situation.
So in the absence of any remedy, do you have any idea what would happen to those young people? You're going to lobby for a remedy, and I understand that, and I would agree with you in terms of, you know, England should change what they're doing. But if that isn't forthcoming, what happens to those young people?
I'm sorry, but as a minister in the Scottish Parliament, that's not something that I can give you assurance on at the moment. That is something that I've said I'll be discussing with the minister, the appropriate minister. However, my focus is on the promise for children in Scotland, and this bill works towards that.
Okay. I think other members would have general concern for the welfare of those young people also. But they're also the money that comes across that is the sector in Scotland in secure care is absolutely dependent on that money at the moment. So we've had evidence given to the Parliament saying, Rossi Young People's Trust say that approximately 50% of current cohort of young people are cross-border placements. How would you imagine, if your stated intention is delivered, that they would continue to meet their costs?
So in terms of the cost, that's something that will need to be a gradual change, but that is exactly what I've already mentioned, the last bed pilot increasing to 16 beds, and that will ensure capacity for Scottish children and meanwhile reducing the capacity for cross-border placements from England to be put in place. And I want to re-emphasise that we are cognisant of the fact that these will still happen in exceptional circumstances. These will still be required to happen, but it's only when it is absolutely essential for the child's welfare.
So can I ask you what allowance you've made within the financial memorandum for cost for a secure care place at the moment, and what that cost will be after the legislation is passed, if there's a difference between the two?
Yes. We have costs. At the moment, the costs for secure care are significantly higher than the costs for young offenders institutions. Sorry for the exact detail on that. I'm just going to pass over to my official, Brendan.
Yep. The costs for secure care placements are run at about £6,500 a week. So as Ms Dawn said, they're significantly more cost intensive than YOI, but that reflects the kind of, you know, the level of provision and support for the young people within them.
So my question was, though, I recognise the difference between Young Offenders Institute and secure care and the difference in cost, but you're still working at that stable cost of 6.5 in secure care after the legislation is passed. Yes? Is that correct? We don't see the allowance increasing. Sorry, Tom McNally.
Thank you, Convener. Yep. So we don't anticipate that the bill itself is going to disturb the usual cost per place, weekly cost per place in secure care. Obviously, those are subject to annual fee level negotiations with the independent providers and with Scotland Excel, who manage the framework contract for COSLA. So we don't anticipate the bill to disturb those specifically. But you asked about the availability of secure care and the impact on the viability of the providers overall, and what the government's interventions for all that meant. I thought it would just be useful to the committee to just to highlight some of the work that we're doing with the secure care centres and some of the commissioners and purchasers around about preparing the Scottish Secure Care offer and to reconfigure that in concert with the providers in order to kind of match up to the expectations and the promise for the period beyond 2030. So, for example, when I guess that your question is premised around about what's going to be the resourcing arrangements in order to sustain the secure arrangements on the basis that they're offered now, the 78 places.
If I can just pursue this point. At the moment, so evidence is given to the Parliament from the Good Shepherd Centre saying that the sector is turning to England to ensure sustainability, and that's a quote. It's based on the fact that people pay above the rate referenced in the Scotland Excel frameworks that Mr McNamara has just mentioned. But the Minister's stated intention is to reduce the number of people who are paying above that rate. So how is the sector going to maintain sustainability if that revenue is removed, Minister?
As I referred to in my previous response, the 16-bed pilot will go a long way to ensuring the viability of secure care centres going forward. And obviously we have a lot of ongoing work around reimagining secure care. So in terms of that, that is a phase that we're going into in order to prepare for the bill, ending YOIs for under-18s and the promise statement that Scotland must fundamentally rethink the purpose, delivery and infrastructure of secure care, being absolutely clear that it is there to provide therapeutic trauma-informed support. So this will create... If you let me finish, please. The work of reimagining secure care goes through four phases, and this... We'll be looking at issues in terms of funding going forward. But as I said, the last bed pilot will be the method at the moment that we are looking to make secure care centres more financially viable.
The last bed pilot is about ensuring that there is emergency surge capacity. So if there is a dispensation where a young person is sent to a secure care unit to make sure that there's a space there, that the place isn't full. But the evidence that the Parliament has had is that up to 50% of the current cohort, it's not one bed or the fact that the place is full, I'm talking about financial sustainability, I think we all are, Minister. There's nothing in the financial memorandum to recognise the removal of that revenue from your policy intent. Is that correct?
Well, that's something that will be looked at when the financial memorandum is updated. And as I say, based on discussions with the Minister, we will have to see how that will play out. It's not simply going to be a case that all cross-border placements are removed the next day. It's going to be an ongoing thing that we are going to be monitoring. And so
it might include, so it could include modelling in terms of that reduction.
It could,
over time.
It could, absolutely.
OK, but that's some assurance, Minister. Can I turn to Ross Greer?
Thanks, Convener. Just a couple of brief questions. The first is about the increase in the number of cases that will go through the hearing system, the relative cost there. So there have been some suggestions that not only obviously will the number of hearings increase, everybody clearly agrees on that, but the complexity of the additional cases will be greater on average than that of existing cases in the system, which has raised questions about the cost per hearing averaged out. So I'd be interested if you give some clarification on whether the cost of the additional hearings is assumed to average out the same as the cost of hearings that are currently in the system, and if so, how would you respond to the suggestion that these hearings are on average likely to be more complex, and if you have a different costing on average for the hearings, if you could expand a little bit on how you came to that average cost.
Just to get into some of the more technical details, I'll bring Tom in for some of the facts and figures around that.
Yeah, so we worked with Children's Hearing Scotland for the Children's Panel element of that and the Children's Reported Administration in terms of the throughput from local authorities, police and other referrers, round about kind of quantifying the demand. But you're quite right, Mr Greer, this is not simply a case of having a kind of, or almost like a unit cost in relation to children and young people. And, you know, it's foreseeable and in many aspects it's reasonable to say that if we're looking to support 16 and 17-year-olds, older young people with arguably more entrenched needs and risks. I suppose that's a legitimate point for colleagues in the hearing system to make. But by the same token, it's also reasonable to say that where there were really entrenched and chronic needs for young people turning 16 and 17-year-old, those may well already have been known to the system, for example. So therefore, I mean, I suppose it's a reasonable projection as well that you would expect most of the additional demand on the hearing system to be on the offence side, and that in turn doesn't, you know, I don't think it lends itself to simplistically suggesting that every one of the additional cases that the children's hearing system would cope with would be of a nature that they simply haven't seen before. So we think it's a reasonably safe projection that we've got. I guess those will be discussions and negotiations that will home in and both with the hearing system bodies themselves, but also probably supported by work that will be taken forward by the Crown Office and SCRA in respect of jointly reported cases, and those will be the ones that will be towards the more serious end. And eventually, you know, the terms of that prosecution policy in terms of what eventually ends up being diverted to the children's reporter and then liable to be considered by a children's hearing, that will be framed by the Lord Advocate in the Crown Office, and it would only be once we've got the benefit of that updated policy that we'd be able to be really, really clear about it. But we think that while it's foreseeable that there is more complexity, we've always kind of tried to respond to additional demand for complexity, because obviously over a number of years now, if you like, the kind of gross number of referrals to the hearing system, whether it's on care and protection or indeed on offence grounds, those have come down appreciably over the year. But we've maintained the funding commitment to the hearings bodies and the wider children's services, recognising that what's left for consideration for compulsory measures tends to be more complex. So they're already dealing with difficult cases.
Thanks very much for that, Tom. And from a policy perspective, completely agree with everything you've said, but just for the sake of clarification, then, can I just confirm that the costings in the memorandum for the additional hearings, and accepting what you say, we shouldn't in general see this as a unit price thing, but for the purposes of the FM, we kind of need to. Is that unit price assumed to be essentially the same as the unit price of the current average in the hearing system, or is it more?
So the material that we have directly from the reporter and also from Children's Hearing Scotland kind of reflects the existing, including 16 and 17-year-olds that the Children's Reporter already sees, anticipates, you know, what would be displaced from the criminal justice system, and that would what would come in afresh in relation to 16 and 17-year-olds on care and welfare grounds, and then kind of converts that into this would be the percentage that went from initial reporter referral onto hearing, and then what would be then the number of appeals, what would be the number of pre-hearing panels. So that's all factored into those figures and numbers.
Grand, thanks very much. And then just one final brief question. Minister, I was really glad to welcome the comments you made to me in Education Committee last week in relation to secure transport, and that the government will be considering bringing amendments to the bill to reflect that, or considering taking measures in this area in one form or another. Will that be taken into account in revising the financial memorandum? Because there's been various submissions, both to suggest that savings could be made in the area of secure transport provision if we were, for example, to create a situation in which secure transport provision existed in Scotland. We've discussed previously how most of it comes from England. But the flip side of that, of course, is if we're trying to raise standards in secure transport provision, that could have additional costs. So I think it would be of interest to Parliament to have some indication of what the financial implication of changes to secure transport provision would be. So accepting that a decision hasn't been made on what those changes will be yet, could you just confirm that the financial memorandum will take that into account?
Yes, I'll thank Mr. Gore for that question. And just for the benefit of the committee, obviously the bill does not make any alterations to the backdrop regulation for secure transport, so it's not quantified in the financial memorandum. However, as I've already said this morning, we are listening to the views that have come forward over stage one on this and a range of other areas, and these will of course be explored in any refreshed financial forecasts for the bill.
Thanks very much. That's all from me, Convener.
Thank you. John Mason.
Thank you very much. I mean, just pursuing this cross-border thing a little bit more, I mean, presumably it is better for a young person to be nearer the local authority area which is responsible for them, because as I understand it, they still are responsible for education and other measures of support.
Yes, absolutely. That's why we're that's why I'm saying that we really don't want these to happen unless they are absolutely essential or for exceptional circumstances. We don't want to remove a young person from everything that they know. And yes, resources and support networks that could be around them. So essentially, to answer your question, Mr. Mason, yes.
So, I mean, you're not suggesting a quick cut-off. You're suggesting this is probably going to take time. But over time, children from Kent and Cornwall should not be coming to Scotland.
Absolutely. This would be a gradual thing. As I said, this is not a case that every child that's in a cross-border placement would be removed in a short period of time. The overall aim is to get to a place where our young people and our children are being protected and being cared for in the areas where they are from, unless there is reasons for them not to do so. So absolutely, we need to make it less encouraging for local authorities in England to want to place children in secure care centres in Scotland and ensure the capacity is there for children within Scotland who require those places.
That's great. Thanks so much. Now, I mean, overall, the costs at the moment, I fully accept there's going to be a new FM or a revised FM, a 10.67 million to 11.94 million in total. I mean, firstly, that is actually a pretty small amount compared to other bills that we've looked at in this committee. I accept it's still money that we need to look at. The other point that struck me about that, though, was how tight the forecast was. There's only a 10% difference there, broadly, between the bottom and the top. And that's a good thing, because sometimes we have seen financial memorandum here before that have been absolutely all over the place. But can you just comment on why, you know, your range is so tight? Because I think some have felt maybe it was too tight.
Yeah, I think that might be a question better directed to one of my officials. So could I ask Tom?
Thank you. I guess, Mr. Mason, the relatively narrow band that you're referring to, the reason why we had the degree of confidence that we did round about that was because those were referable to those sort of tripartite discussions that I mentioned earlier on with Mr. Lumsden, with the Crown Office, and with the Children's Reporter, and that was kind of looking at, these were the types of cases, for example, the number and the gravity, if you like, that if the bill's kind of structural changes were to go through, that at that time, that they felt were kind of liable to displacement across to the children's system. So therefore, and those in turn were referable to kind of real world under 18s cases that the Crown Office had dealt with in times past, and then the ones that had been liable to kind of the joint referral mechanism between the Crown Office and the Children's Reporter, and then which system ended up taking them. So those were based on those discussions, and therefore we felt reasonably confident about that was the sort of kind of the size of the shift in demand.
So although the future is never predictable, in one sense, this bill, the costs are a little bit more predictable than some other areas of legislation.
I wouldn't make that claim, but I guess what we're saying is that we've discussed with the, you know, the relevant prosecutorial and the relevant statutory agencies in the children's domain, and they've both taken an informed view round about this is the kind of the range of cases that we'd be likely to move across, with reference to like the real world data around about the cases that they dealt with under the old arrangements, and therefore we felt reasonably confident to be pretty tight round about that. And again, that was about trying to offer Parliament as much precision as where we could, while recognising that each and every one of those cases are, and you know, in the ultimate analysis, those are in the individual professional prosecutorial gift of the Crown Office.
Okay, thank you. And When it comes to funding for local authorities, can you say anything about how that would be distributed among local authorities? Because you might have a few years, say, with nobody from Shetland needing the change service. So does that mean Shetland would get no money for these years? And if Glasgow, say, had more than its share of young people, it would get a bit more?
As far as I'm aware, that would take place through the usual budget process. However, that could, if that specific situation did become an issue, that could be monitored going forward. And there also is discussion between the secure care centres within Scotland where they can manage issues like this. So I'm confident that could be managed going forward.
Yes, because I mean, some money does get shared out, doesn't it, in different ways to local governments. Some is by population share and some is by need or other methods.
So, yeah, so at the moment, as I say, that as far as I'm aware, the way it would currently lie is it would get distributed through the normal budget process. But as I say, we would have to monitor that if it did turn out that there was lots of young people needing secure care in this area and not so much somewhere else, then that would need to be looked at going forward. But as I say, the secure care centres do have these discussions among themselves and can work sort of work these out, so that could be addressed.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Keith Brown.
Thanks, Convener. Just to come back again to the cross-border situation, I understand the point that you are only legally responsible for what happens in Scotland and not for what happens because of failings south of the border. However, there are cases which I'm sure you're aware of young people being accommodated well away from home, bed and breakfast, with private security guards outside their door in some pretty bad situations. Now, as long as the government was able to guarantee that the last bed was available, and I know your responsibility to make sure everyone in Scotland has got the accommodation, has there been a kind of in principle rejection of the idea that if there were available beds, that they could and should be available to people from elsewhere, to go back to the convener's point, to help with the financial sustainability of the entire system? If we have the people in the accommodation here in Scotland and there are some available, and I know that's not an easy thing to do because you've got to judge how it fluctuates, but why would we not want to do that?
Yeah, I can understand that. And as I say, my priority would be ensuring that there is capacity and space for children within Scotland who require it. I would also, as I say, in my meeting with Claire Coutinho, I will be encouraging the practice and changes to the practice in England. I mean, as part of the ongoing engagement with the UK government so far, and again, this predates some of my time in office, but we do continue to emphasise the importance of addressing that lack of capacity in adequate care accommodation in England. We do now have a place, a memorandum of understanding, which underpins regular discussions on these issues, and I'm going to be taking these forward now. This commenced in March 2023, and it is allowing us to pursue the UK government's intended course of action, particularly in response to its independent care review. So these discussions are ongoing. I understand the Mr Brown's point around if there was capacity in Scotland. However, the priority is to ensure capacity in Scotland and ensure that capacity in England as well, working with the appropriate minister.
Understand the priority. I just think there's a big opportunity there which might serve everyone's interests, including the financial sustainability. Hey, the other and last question I had was in relation to sections 12, 13 and 14. It's mainly to do with children at court, and it gives a reason, amongst others, for why more information is not available, more financial information is not available in the FM. One of the reasons given is because of the reluctance to cut across judicial discretion. I can't say I find that very convincing, the idea that a judge or sheriff will think twice about their decision because somewhere there's an indicative budget being attached to it. And I just wondered whether an imaginative response might be to say, if you agreed with the judiciary through discussions, this will be an indicative budget and it's only for that purpose, but it might help the Parliament look at some of the potential costs at the same time as making sure that the judiciary didn't feel they were being in any way fettered.
Yeah.
No, I understand that is an issue, and that could certainly be looked into for the updated financial costs, absolutely.
Okay. Douglas Lumsden. Yeah, I just want to come back in on something that John Mason was asking about. In terms of the lower cost estimates and the upper end cost estimates, for part 2 and 3, the under 18s being kept in young offenders institutions, secure accommodation, it's fixed, it's 5.41 million in the lower cost estimate and 5.41 in the upper cost estimate. It seems quite unusual that there's no difference between those two. Can you give us some explanation on that? Is it completely fixed?
I'm sorry for the details on those specifics. I would need to pass over to Brendan.
Yeah, Mr. Lumsden. Yeah, I mean, again, I suppose they were are they completely fixed? We've kind of talked about inflationary costs and other issues. I mean, at the time, those were the best forecasts we could give to try and get as much precision as possible. As we've said, they're based on the kind of current sort of weekly or annual cost of secure care at that point in time. So that's why they're in that kind of reasonably fixed range. But again, I mean, those are predicated as well on number of children in secure care, in YOIs being at 16. So there was kind of care taken with the financial memo not to underestimate the cost there to both central and local government. So as the Minister said, there's currently 5 children on the current figures in young offenders institutions that under these provisions would transfer to secure. So the costs there are probably significantly more than they would be at this given moment. So again, there is just that point. There's been a lot of discussion about the fluctuation. The numbers do go up and down, but at that time they were deemed to be the most appropriate.
Yeah, so it does look like it's based on the 6,500 weekly costs for secure accommodation. So I guess my final question was, in terms of secure accommodation costs, is that the same for a 12-year-old in secure accommodation as a 17-year-old in secure accommodation? Or would we expect to see differences in the cost?
Well, if it'd be helpful to just add to what Brendan said there. So the weekly cost of a placement in each secure centre is agreed as part of our usual annual contractual negotiation. So that's why there's no fluctuation in that. So the staffing arrangements, the sort of high fixed costs associated with a secure care placement in a given centre is negotiated via Scotland Excel with each of the centres at the beginning of each year. And that, in broad terms, doesn't vary dependent on age. So what's required to support each child or young person who's placed in secure care is really very, very intensive. So those are the usual anticipated costs. There is flexibility in even, an even smaller microcosm of that very small demand and high demand cohort of young people for additional kind of augmentation and reinforcement to be put round about an individual child. So, for example, if you need to have space and bedrooms either side, or you need additional specialist input, etc. In addition to the kind of average £6,500 to £7,000 a week cost, where an individual child in an individual case needs something extra, that's negotiated with the individual centre.
But you don't anticipate secure accommodation providers to charge more for a 17-year-old?
No, we don't, because secure accommodation providers already care for 17-year-olds. So the average age of a child in secure care is round about 15 and a half, 16 at the moment anyway. They already care for 17-year-olds. The key distinction for the bill is the supervision status of the kids going into secure care.
Okay, thank you.
So there's no intention at the moment then to revisit the Scotland Excel framework in terms of the costs that are paid?
Not in direct consequence of the bill. That's why I suppose during my earlier remarks, the bill cuts into a context that's kind of suffused with change anyway, round about the necessity of sustainability of the existing centres. That's predicated on the 78 beds in the 4 centres. When we're engaged in a kind of promise keeping exercise, alongside the secure care centres to reimagine and reconfigure secure care and to meet Scotland's needs in the period beyond 2030. What might be needed to ensure viability in that period might not be the same as the current sort of 90% occupancy break-even. So, and in terms of, you know, national contribution, local contribution in Scotland, and what secure care centres might need in the period beyond 2030 might look a wee bit different.
And that's partly based on the evidence that we've had that the sector relies on cross-border placement money to actually keep the lights on.
It's very important to them under the current funding arrangements and the current contractual arrangements.
Up to 50% of placements.
But again, the prevalence of cross-border placements varies from centre to centre as well. So the extent of that reliance does differ from centre to centre. So therefore, the extent of the expectation and the contribution that Scottish Government and other partners would make to kind of resolving that over time will need to vary as well.
Four centres, and certainly I have evidence here from two of them stating that they're reliant on that money. Yeah, I suppose it's worth the emphasis, Minister, in terms of, you know, this is not a marginal issue in terms of your stated policy intent of reducing or eliminating those people. And I think it's reflected across the committee that there are real concerns both for those young people, frankly, and their welfare, young people in England, as well as young people in Scotland. I understand your legal responsibility in these regards, but on a human level, I think we all have great concern for the outcomes for those young people as well. But also, more generally, the fact that we have a sector that is entirely dependent on that money. And I'm not really hearing a lot of evidence today from you, Minister, or from your officials that actually we're dealing with that in the long run. There's talk about dealing it in 2030. And we also, you know, let's hope that this meeting with agencies in June can come up with some answers. And when we see the second financial memorandum, it's in a state that we could agree with. OK, thank you. Thanks for your evidence today, Minister and officials. And that closes the public part of our meeting. We'll take the rest of the agenda in private. Thank you.